But then I start, you tell me that there is no option of cement, and then I start looking for a real conservative treatment, and you will look what happened. So, and you know very well that there is the cortical trabecular bone loss in this osteoporotic situation, and we end up like this. And we are getting more and more familiar with T-scores, and it's normal in minus one, and severe osteoporotic when it's minus 2.5. And then we know that decreased asymmetrical and irregular bone density is the hallmark of osteoporotic bones, and may cause wedge-shaped compression fractures, acquired kyphosis, and general height loss. So what's going on? When we have the axial load, then bending the vertebras and start the breakage, and then we have a gravity center reposition, posterior elements failure, the patient falls and make more fractures, and then we have loose height and also posture body changes, and finally, progressive kyphosis, additional fracture, neurological changes, and all this can be minimized with approximate expeditious care, which is now based on the portion of the vertebral body that is affected. We have the anterior, the concave in the medial position, and the crus. This is a score that we can we can use. And 35 years ago, they believed that spontaneous crush fracture never complicated, so it's a benign disease. But in USA, 700 new fractures every year, 100,000 hospitalization, and close to 1.5 billion in annual costs show us that we have to do something about this. So they decided that cord compression do occur in osteoporotic patients in early time, and they should be treated. You know, all aware, you are aware of this, where we have back pains, decreased lung capacity, and then end to 23.5 increased mortality. So they decided that osteoporosis is not finally an innocent disease. It has complications and disabilities, and it is progressive, and maybe the complications become devastating. This could create this situation. So this is how kyphoplasty get into our lives. All vertebral fractures require a systematic examination to rule out an underlying systemic illness, and this is the truth. We must search about malignancy, infection, renal or liver disease. We must make laboratory studies to which include blood count, basic serum chemistry profile, ESR, CRP, and calcium, alkaline phosphatide, serum and urine electrophoresis, etc. Of course, we must do the imaging studies, plain x-rays here, plain radiographies, simple, easy, quick, and diagnostic. We can have evaluation of the location, integrity, as well as pressures, presence of fractures. Certain characteristics of suggestive osteopenia is increased lucency, loss of horizontal trabecula, and decreased cortical thickness, but increased relative opacity of the end plates. So, computer to CT scan is very helpful and very sensitive, even for subtle fractures like this. And MRI can also help to detect new fractures. STEER sequence is the most sensitive, and we can see how a fracture started. T2 means acute fracture because of edema, and gives you a high signal. And here we can see the STEER sequence shows this kind of fracture. In these cases, maybe a small fracture cannot be seen in the MRI, and that's why CT is needed. And if you cannot perform that, maybe bone scan will help in conjunction with DEXA scan. Biomechanics maybe enter in things like this, and so we have to be critical in deciding the treatment regimen if the patient is in pain and if the vertebral collapse is the percentage of vertebral collapse. So if pain is 4 out of 10 and vertebral collapse more than 40%, then kyphoplasty or vertebroplasty is indicated. In other cases, may initially attempt more conservative treatment. And what is this? According to American College of Radiology, conservative treatment could be the traditional first-line therapy for painful, I say again, painful vertebral compression fractures. So in most patients, pain from these fractures may resolve spontaneously even without a medication. What we need is short-time bed rest, physical therapy, bracing, and medication. In physical therapy, we have to exercise and exchange axial muscle strength. We have to early mobilize to prevent complications of immobility. We must strengthen back exercises and improving as we can kyphotic deformity, and back extension exercises are needed. So bracing used, but it's not right to be common because we have problems mainly in increased stress of the posterior elements of the spine. Pain relief is a paramount concern, and that's why painkillers have a very good state here. So non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, muscle relaxant, narcotic pains, and all these things like local anesthetics and maybe transcutaneous nerve block. But strong analgesic may cause, because we have elderly patients, may cause confusion, disorientation, increased risk of falling, constipation, and respiratory depression. So even this is not so innocent. The agents to treat osteoporosis is bisphosphonates, selective estrogen receptors, recombinant parathyroid hormone, and calcitonin. Calcitonin, bisphosphonates, and maybe teriparatid looks like they help in control pain. Second degeneration of bisphosphonates, you will see about that later on. This is it. Orally bampronate, about 150 milligrams per month, or aledronate, 70 milligrams per week. Calcium, vitamin D3 and C. Mialgic can be taken intranasally and has been reported that reduce pain from compression fractures. So it offers dose-dependent protection against fractures. How bisphosphonates works? It works double. First, it releasing locally during bone resorption and promotes osteoclast apoptosis. And then they stop signaling from osteoblasts to osteoclasts. So this is these two works that it has to be done. Ibampronate, 3 milligrams per 3 ml. Prefilled syringe is given intravenous. Zoledronic acid, 5 milligrams. And patients should be prepared with acetaminophen to reduce risk of an acute phase of reaction. In alendronate, we have, if we want to use the prevention dose, this is 5 milligrams per day, and to treatment is 10 milligrams per day. And of course, all of this have had side effects and a lot of problems. And don't forget that all bisphosphonates are contraindicated in patients with estimated GFR below 30 or 35 ml. The selective estrogen receptors, so-called F-SERMs, like raloxifene, could be used in 60 milligrams per day, and there are side effects as well as zoledronic. The hormone therapy with teriparatide could be approved for the treatment of osteoporosis and is associated with sustained systemic glucocorticoid therapy. So even if they are male or female who are taking this kind of therapy, you can use teriparatide for to prevent the osteoporosis. There is a very good paper for 38 patients with 20 microgram teriparatide daily, and they assessed radiographic for union status, vertebral kyphosis, and mid-vertebral body height. They followed 27 months, and they find that there were hematological significant change on conservative treatment. And there was also levels of hormone significant decrease, but there was no significant changes in alkaline phosphatide. Denosamp is a new trend, and this is a human monoclonal antibody and works by preventing the development of osteoclasts. There is a contraindication when we have low blood calcium. And if we want to have a quick look, this is what is the conservative treatment with bisphosphonates, SERMs, which has very, very big problems, so they tend to not to use it, and calcitonin, teriparatide, and denosumab. So in addition to all this, the patient must consultate. He must modify his activities, and he must be careful with the pneumococcal vaccine and yearly influenza vaccinations, because most of them, even with cooking, they can have fractures. We must search for these underlying diseases, and psychiatric consultation as well as a rheumatologist is appropriate to help this kind of people. This is a very good last paper, which shows a multidisciplinary approach in this kind of patients, and if they would do so, they will alleviate pain, decrease disability, reduce morbidity, and could be effective in preventing further progression of their disease. And with all this, I would like to stress that really there is a paucity of literature on conservative therapy, because normally this is used as a control group to patients who are operated on. And thank you very much from Rhodes to the Mount Olympus, and also thank not only these professors, but all professors that came and support our last year, Hellenic Spine Society, and I hope we will do it again. Thank you very much.